like to say that we're balanced and a team that can run as well as pass. We're going to lean to the run a little bit, and I'm sure South Carolina will lean to stopping the run. But what the defense gives us and what we can do best is what we'll take. I don't expect a letdown from our football team. We haven't been a team that's been like that in the past, and I expect us to get better as the season goes along. And this is one of our 11 opportunities, and it's very important that we take advantage of all the 11 opportunities that we're given, one play at a time, one game at a time. So I expect us to be better this week than we were last.
Hi again, everybody. I'm Bob Bell, along with former University of Tennessee quarterback Andy Kelly and former South Carolina great Todd Ellis. It's good to have you with us today for this SEC battle in Knoxville. Tennessee is a heavy favorite in this game today. We'll talk with Todd about that in a moment. But first of all, Andy, the Tennessee defense, you can't say enough about the Vol defense. They have been magnificent all year.
Well, they really have. Starting out, looking at last week's game, you're playing Sean Alexander and Heisman Trophy candidate, probably one of the front runners with a good offensive line in front of him. They held Sean Alexander under 100 yards. Nobody's been able to do that all year. Not only against Alabama, but all season long, Tennessee's held every opponent under 100 yards rushing. I'll go along with that, no rushing touchdowns. Anytime your defense can perform like that, it really doesn't matter what your offense does. Your defense is going to give yourself, put your team an opportunity to have a chance to win the game.
Well, Todd, South Carolina offensively has had all kinds of problems using six different quarterbacks this year. But you look on the positive side, the defense has played very well.
They really have, despite the fact that we've had 27 turnovers on offense and scoring only 7 points per game. Our defense has held up very well under the circumstances, ranked third overall in total defense, second in passing defense in the SEC. But when you play the Volunteers, you better get a little help from your offense to keep the T. Martin and that crew off the field.
Well, let's go down on the sidelines now and get the perspective from down there. Former Vol wide receiver Terrence Cleveland. Terrence?
Guys, I was able to talk to both of the coordinators before the game of Tennessee. Defensive coordinator John Chavis said Tennessee's going to play well against the option by getting off the blocks and maintaining good pursuit to the football. If they're successful at doing that, he hopes that that'll force South Carolina into throwing the football and Tennessee can lay their ears back and really come after them. Offensive coordinator Randy Sanders said South Carolina does a good job of spreading out the football field, hoping to make the opposing teams go the long distance using 8 to 10 play drives. Both of the coordinators today would like to have an opportunity to play some young players, give some guys some quality time. It's going to be a problem today, though, because Tennessee faces an opponent outside of South Carolina, the bowl championship series that was just released, and Tennessee is ranked number 4. Hopefully today, Tennessee will be able to cover the 33-point spread and give their young players an opportunity to get some quality playing time. Back upstairs to the booth.
Okay, thank you very much, Terrence. The giant T has been formed down on the field. The Tennessee team will break through there in a moment. Down to our right, the South Carolina Gamecocks will break out onto the field. Tennessee going for their 20th straight win here in Neyland, and South Carolina trying to get into the win column for the first time this year. In fact, they've got an 18-game skid going. And Todd, I guess you could say South Carolina's got everything to win or lose right here. I mean, they have got to be the loosest of the two teams.
Yeah, I would agree with that. As a matter of fact, Lou Holtz broke tradition yesterday. Really interesting. Came over to work out at the field here, Neyland Stadium, but then let his players walk around the Volunteer campus, go to a class, see the practice facility, kept them loose and busy all day long. He also ran some routes. That was kind of interesting as well to see Lou Holtz do a down and out with a couple of his quarterbacks. Kept them loose.
All right, South Carolina breaks onto the field. The Tennessee Vols break through the tee, led by the blue tick hound, Smokey. And we're set for football. You could not ask for a more perfect day. It is just absolutely ideal football weather. And we're expecting a crowd, of course, in excess of 100,000 here at the Big House in East Tennessee. Andy, Tennessee came in here favored by a tremendous amount of points over Memphis and barely got out of here alive, so you have to wonder about a letdown. And there's Coach Philip Fulmer, his overall record 72-12. He's got to do a little motivating today.
Well, you really do. And, you know, the spread really doesn't matter unless you get out and take care of business. As you said, Memphis is a prime example. Tennessee was a heavy favorite, came out, struggled all day. Memphis had a good game plan, took Tennessee to the wire. It could be the same thing today. If you're a heavy favorite, you have to come out and take care of business first.
On the other side, you have Lou Holtz, whose record against Tennessee is 1-1, but that was at Notre Dame. Notre Dame, of course, coming in here next week. Todd, there's no doubt this is a great motivator himself. Lou Holtz, one of the real firebrands in the world of coaching. So I think everybody at South Carolina surely knows he will in time get it done.
He has been successful at every program in his second year of every stay. He's taken the team to a bowl game, won a national championship, coach of the year. His impact on the South Carolina program has been incredible. 1,300 women, 500 more than the previous year, attended a Holtz clinic at Carolina Kids Coliseum. We sold a record 53,000 season tickets. Now we just need to get some W's to go with it.
Well, there you see it, 64 degrees, wind out of the north at 9, and forecast for a perfect day here. No rain, no clouds even in sight, so it's just ideal here in East Tennessee. It's a beautiful, beautiful weekend with the leaves changing, and it's perfect for Southeastern Conference football. Just an ideal painting, you might say. And the Volunteers still very much in the national hunt. They will have to have a little help along the way, Andy, but they know they do have that chance. And when you have that chance, that's the most important thing. There's the record you see. Tennessee has won 9 straight here and has the distinct edge in the series against South Carolina. Here come the paratroopers onto the field. Quite a sight right there.
Bob, you mentioned the series record. At Neyland Stadium, the Gamecocks are 0-9 here. And what's interesting as well, and I know it's important to Tennessee today with the BCS, is that only in 2 of those games has that margin been less than 2 touchdowns. So the Gamecocks have got their work cut out for them today, working against history and the numbers here at Neyland Stadium.
All right, the paratroopers are still on their way down to hopefully the center of the field here, delivering the game ball, and we'll be getting underway. Now the shadow of the parachute is just descending onto the surface here at Neyland Stadium. Better them than me, Andy.
I don't think you can get me up in that. I don't like getting in airplanes, let alone jumping out of them.
This is quite a sight. The United States Army team. It looks like an ideal jump, and it is at the 37-yard line.
I wonder if we brought in some offensive linemen for South Carolina. We could use a few of those.
Here comes the second of the shootest down. And he's going to hit right on the 50. And now the third U.S. Army parachute team dropping into Neyland Stadium. And again, it's right about the 45-yard line.
Bob, you mentioned the 1992 ball game when South Carolina, in its first year in the SEC, upset the Vols on a Halloween weekend when a lot of orange and black was out. That was in Williams-Brice Stadium, 24-23. And really, we think we launched Phil Fulmer's career at that point in that time when he was an interim coach, went on to win 4 games that year, and of course has not looked back.
Well, you see the comparison between the two teams this year. The most shocking fact, of course, is that South Carolina has not been able to win a ball game with all their problems on offense. But again, we point out that defensively, this team is capable of keeping themselves into the ball game. So that's what concerns the Tennessee Volunteers today, as the U.S. Army parachute team has dropped into Neyland Stadium. And 64 degrees, you couldn't ask for a better setting and a better day for football. South Carolina has had another bit of bad luck this year, Todd, in that they're the last team in the league to get an open date.
Yes.
And certainly they could have used one prior to this one coming up.
Bob, it's an excellent point. You know, when you come into the league last, Arkansas and South Carolina, obviously you're going to have some scheduling difficulties. But South Carolina plays eight straight games without an open date. And, of course, we know that Tennessee has already had two, only played six games so far. So I know that there's talk at the SEC conference office about amending that two permanent opposite division opponents and make that at 1-1 so we could make the schedule a little more flexible and allow some of these other teams to have earlier open dates. But it's when you're 0-8 and you haven't had a week off, it is doubly difficult.
Here comes quite a sight. We have two parachutists together right here. What a scene that is. They break apart about 15 feet above the ground, and here comes yet another. Apparently, guys, we have the entire United States Army parachute team here today. And I do mean entire. They're still dropping out of the sky.
Hey, that's quite a showing. Almost all of them hit right on, almost right on the 50, right on the tee. That the crowd really enjoyed that.
This one carrying a camera, a helmet camera there. Well, guys, Halloween weekend has produced a lot of stories in the Southeastern Conference. The most famous run in the history of SEC football. They refer to it as the Halloween night run of Billy Cannon of LSU against Ole Miss. So Halloween weekend has brought some shocking surprises. On that particular game, LSU won. Ole Miss came back and beat them in a bowl game rather handily. So who knows?
And who plays today? LSU and Ole Miss again on Halloween weekend.
As a great ghost. And the other thing, too, is that Tennessee has not done well after open day weekends and playing Alabama. If they have letdowns, that tends to be the case. And, of course, they play Notre Dame next weekend.
All right, Tennessee will be receiving here, and the South Carolina Gamecocks will be kicking off. Steve Florio and the Volunteers will try to get it off on a positive note as their offense will take the field first. Leonard Scott and Cedric Wilson handle the kick return duties for the Volunteers. Carolina all in white today, trimmed in black. The Vols, of course, with their traditional home orange jerseys, which they always feel more comfortable in. Leonard Scott is actually taking the kickoff by himself, and he comes up to the 10-yard line, bobbles it, retrieves it, gets to the 30, and is still on his feet to the 35, to the 37-yard line. Great return by Leonard Scott. The great Scott. So the Volunteers will put it in play in very good field position to begin this ball game. Coming off a big win last week against Alabama, 21-7, down in Tuscaloosa. The only blemish, of course, the two-point loss at Florida in the second game of the year. T. Martin has gotten better and better with each contest, getting more confident, especially his running was effective against the South Carolina team. He wants to throw on first down. He's got a man down there, just overthrew him a bit. Tennessee wanted interference, and there is a flag on the play, and it probably will be interference. Referee Steve Landis tells it's holding on defense.
We see Tennessee coming out aggressive early. When you're playing a game like this, as we said earlier, I think it's important for Tennessee to come out and establish something very early and try to jump on South Carolina. They have struggled. If you can jump on a team like that early, it could take them out of the game.
Well, there's a man who can jump on you quickly. That's Jamal down to the 45. Here's the Vols offense. Chad Clifton, Fred Weary, Spencer Riley, Cozy Coleman, and Josh Tucker up front. And in the backfield, T. Martin, Jamal Lewis, Philip Crosby at fullback, Cedric Wilson, David Martin, and John Finlinson at tight end. All right, T. Martin hands it off to the big back, and he rambles and rolls down to the 39-yard line. Jamal Lewis. All right, let's take a look at the defense. Marsters, Caldwell, Pinckney, and Edwards up front defensively. The linebackers in there, a very active group, although they're missing their number one guy, Marco Hutchinson, and he's filling in for the injured star today. And there you see the backfield. Arturo Freeman is certainly the biggest name in the bunch. Here's a sweep with Jamal Lewis to his left. Got a little blocking, got on the corner. Not quite to the first down marker, but a good positive run. He's hit by Arturo Freeman. The secondary, Todd, has, I guess, held up their end of the bargain pretty good this year.
Yeah, you look at the run support here as Jamal Lewis goes to the outside. Tennessee doing a nice job of getting their backs and linemen out in front. But Ray Green, who led the team in tackles last year, coming up on the corner, and you see Arturo Freeman there as well, our preseason All-American at the free safety position.
Tennessee splits two wide outs to the bottom of your screen. High backfield, they give it off to Jamal, and he's got a hole as he goes down to the 25-yard line and maybe a shade shy of the 25. Stop was made by Harding, linebacker.
We see Tennessee came out early, first play of the game, took a shot downfield, and since then everything's been on the ground. It looks like the offensive line for Tennessee is just continuing what went on the second half against Alabama. They took control of the game in that second half, and they're coming out this week and trying to establish something early on the ground in the first half of this game.
Well, Lewis has got four carries for 27 yards to this point. Two wideouts again on the right side. Again, they hand it to Lewis, who runs behind his left guard for a couple of yards to about the 24-yard line before the stop is made by Stamper.
Stamper's another defensive player, been hampered by injuries, but he is a scrappy player. The defensive coordinator, Charlie Strong, says he likes to put players in there that are fresh, will play hard, use their hands, and John Stamper continues to get more reps as his ankle gets a little bit better.
All right, the balls break out of there right now. Marching downfield, looking at a second down situation. About nine, T goes into a shotgun formation right here. Standing at his 30, backing up, getting a little pressure, screens it out on the left side. Good call. Down to the five, down to the goal line, and in is Ontario Smith, a true freshman from California. Big things were expected of him this year, even though he is a true freshman. They have worked him slowly into the lineup, Andy. And obviously they have done a good job at getting him prepared.
Well, Tennessee came out with three wides, went into the shotgun, ran a little screen. I'll tell you the best part about this play, when Smith set up his block, he had a guy in front of him, had a lineman out in front and a corner. He actually hesitated for a second, set up his block, and did the rest on his own. But a nice play call and a nice job by Smith using his blocker.
Alex Walls adds on the extra point, and the Volunteers have gone on top of South Carolina with 12:16 to go in the first quarter. Tennessee marches downfield. Remember, Leonard Scott brought the kickoff back to the 37-yard line in good field position, and then a crisp drive downfield, and Tennessee's on top by a score of 7-0.
Well, if you're Lou Holtz, that's not the way you wanted to draw up the start of this ball game. As Andy pointed out, they tried the one long pass, but basically doing it with their offensive line and their great running backs. Now South Carolina's got to find a way to respond immediately, because you let them get two up on you, it's going to be in trouble. Tennessee's got an unbelievable record of like 39-0 in the 90s since when they've scored first.
Coach Philip Fulmer pacing the sidelines. He knows every game is big, even though his team's heavily favored today. He knows that you've got to be impressive with the BCS folks, and certainly he knows South Carolina's not going to roll over and play dead. Lou Holtz will motivate this team to the best of his ability today, even though it's a very young team and a team that's been really racked with injuries. As we pointed out at the beginning of the game, they've used as many as six different quarterbacks, and their number one quarterback is certainly not here. All right, David Leverton will be kicking off, and he's done a good job in recent games. Since the injury to Loudermilk, he assumed that duty. Derek Watson is the deep man for South Carolina, and Leverton's kick is going to go to a short man at the 11-yard line. Pretty good return, still battling, and South Carolina will be in decent position close to the 30-yard line. Let's take another look, Andy, at the touchdown.
Well, again, we go back to a good play call, nice execution, and you see Smith actually You see Riley out in front. He hesitated, cut back inside. Riley used his block well, and then actually broke a tackle at the five to get it in the end zone. But a great effort by Smith, using his block and then using some strength to get it in the end zone.
All right. South Carolina comes up to the line of scrimmage with Goodman at quarterback. Derek Watson is the tailback. Almost came to Tennessee. And he's stacked up at the line of scrimmage. Gain of practically nothing right there as the right side of the defense collapsed on him for the University of Tennessee. Again, Tennessee has not permitted a rushing touchdown this entire year. And no other school in Division I or Division I AA. 236 schools can make that claim. So tells you a little bit about the D for Tennessee. There's the number situation on Mikael Goodman, a youngster who played with some poise. Tennessee jumps offside but got back, apparently did not make contact. Here is Goodman back, stumbling to his right, trying to get away from the rush, and fires downfield incomplete.
The one thing about Mikael Goodman is he tries not to hurt your football team. He's limited his ability to throw with what we saw. He's had an injured right hand, a stress fracture in that hand. But he doesn't throw interceptions, and that's what Lou Holtz likes about him. That he has a little savvy about him. He's not afraid to scramble out of the pocket.
All right, you take a look at the starting offensive line there. Williams, Moore, Jones, Johnson, and Rivers. And in the backfield, headed up by Goodman at quarterback. And they got fine receivers there. You'll especially like Kelly and Hood. They do a good job. He's going to change his play at the line of scrimmage. And taking quite a bit of time, but he's still got a second or two to get it off. And he does, and Tennessee almost let him slip away. A flag has been dropped on the play as Nesmith carried the ball and Overstreet made the hit. But we do have a flag down.
Antoine Nesmith getting the start at tailback. Got a face mask there on Tennessee, as we see. But Antoine is a kind of a tweener for us. He's too small to play fullback.
5 yard. Incidental face mask against the defense. 5 yard penalty. Repeat third down.
You saw it was an incidental face mask, which carries a 5 yard penalty. Watson will play today. Nesmith in there now. Sean Ellis, John Henderson, Darwin Walker, and Will Overstreet on the D line. Linebackers Westmoreland, Stevenson, and Thompson. And in the secondary, Lott Goodrich. Fred White starting today. And Deion Grant, and of course Grant leading the nation in interceptions with 6. Kind of a busted play at the line of scrimmage, and Tennessee is all over this one.
I think they tried the quarterback draw there out of the shotgun. Goodman has some mobility. He's not afraid to run the football, so they put in the spread offense, and on third and 5, just tried to run for it there. Unsuccessful, though.
All right, the Volunteers now have held, and so South Carolina will be punting. And standing back is Eric Parker to receive for the Tennessee Vols. Courtney Leavitt is the punter for South Carolina. It's away a kick. It's a low sailer, and Parker takes it with some room maybe to run. Bounces off of one man, tries to get outside. Still on his feet and battling up close to midfield, maybe a yard shy of midfield, where Tennessee will go on first down and 10. Go on offense at that point. Vols leading in the first quarter by a score of 7-0. Their opening drive was 6 plays, covered 63 yards, took 2:44 off the clock, and was capped a 24-yard pass to Ontario Smith, the true freshman from California who took it in for Tennessee's score.
I'll tell you, Bob, I think it's interesting. You see Ontario Smith going into the game today before Travis Henry actually got a chance to play. That's something interesting than something I really didn't expect to see, him going into the game before Henry. But it obviously worked out well for Tennessee.
37-yard punt, 18 yards on the return. Might have been a message to Travis, who fumbled in the Alabama game when they were going in for what looked like another touchdown, and he fumbled down around the 5-yard line. So
maybe just a little reminder how important it is to hold on to the football.
That plus the fact this probably was a design play just for Ontario Smith.
Could be. We've seen Tennessee a couple times this year when Smith does, when he is in the game, they try to get the ball to him against I guess it was against Georgia, a couple of plays, a couple of trick plays, like a little reverse action, and then against Alabama when he ran a just a one-man route, actually, out of the backfield, trying to hit him for a big one there. So they have tried to set up a few special plays just for Smith, and that could have been one of them there, just the screen.
All right, the Volunteers break out of there in great field position again on their own 49-yard line. They'll put it in play right there. First and 10, two wide outs at the top of the screen. T fakes to his back and then goes deep. He's got a man wide open. Down to the 5 and down to the 4 and dropped the football. Dropped the football when he had an absolute sure touchdown. And that was Cedric Wilson, who doesn't drop many.
There's a reason why he's averaging 99.7 yards a game receptions. And that's because he's got skills and he's got speed. You see him here going against our potential All-American and Arturo Freeman. And Arturo can run, I can assure you that. But Wilson just dropping the ball there. No excuse for that.
Went right through the hands. T. Martin. Six receivers on each side and then gives it to his tailback. And he crosses midfield for about 3 yards before Jamal is dropped. Skip Holtz is the son of the coach and the offensive coordinator for South Carolina. Does Lou actually let him call the plays a ton?
What I see on the sidelines, maybe three quarters of the time. Lou certainly has his input in there.
All right, the Volunteers now looking at a 3rd and 7 situation right here after the drop pass and then the 3-yard run. T. Martin is back to throw, fires it out in the flat, incomplete. Tennessee has Jamal Lewis drop the football this time. So that was a real sloppy series on the part of Tennessee, Andy.
It really was. Tennessee got the ball. The defense held, got the ball in great field position, almost at the 50-yard line. And, the big drop by Wilson, and then you come back right back, and Lewis drops it. May not have gotten the first down, but anytime he's got the ball in his hands out in the open field, he's going to have a chance to make something happen. But you can't run until you get the ball.
David Leverton will be back in punt formation for the Volunteers. He's averaging a little over 40 yards per kick and has had some great kicks inside the 10-yard line. This one is a high one. And it's going to be taken, and a lane opens up for South Carolina. Great return out to the 36-yard line. Tell you what, it just kind of collapsed there in the middle defensively for Tennessee. Ryan Brewer had one more man, I guess, Todd, or he would have been still running.
Yeah, Ryan is a very versatile player. Mr. Ohio football. You see him here taking the punt and then just going right up the middle, which is what you need to do on your punt return teams. He's one of 3 Mr. Footballs that we have on our team that were all freshmen.
Red White was the man who made the stop that time for Tennessee. A 32-yard punt and a 20 on the return. So South Carolina in pretty good position. Tennessee jumped offside, so it would be a free play right here for South Carolina. And is taken out by Derek Watson out across the 45 to about the 40, across the 40 to about the 43-yard line. But I think Tennessee jumped into the neutral zone. Flag was dropped on the far side of the field.
You know, we talked all year, Bob, about Tennessee's defense, how aggressive they are, and ways you can combat that. You know, like we said, the screens, the quick passes, moving the quarterback a little bit. But another way, and it looks like South Carolina's taking advantage of it so far today with one penalty, and earlier it could have been a penalty, but with a hard snap count. You know, if you got a defensive line that's trying to get off the ball.
Offside on the defense, 5-yard penalty, repeat first down.
You know, Tennessee's an aggressive defense. They try to time the snap count. They try to get off as quickly as they can on the ball. And another way to slow that down is change the snap count out and use a hard count. And South Carolina's done that a couple times. They've gotten one penalty and almost another one earlier.
Well, it's at the 41-yard line where it becomes first down and 5 for South Carolina. In very good shape, Tennessee jumped again. And South Carolina takes it all the way up to the midfield stripe. Mikhail Goodman keeping it there, but that was another free play. It pretty obvious Tennessee jumped. I don't think they were drawn. I didn't see any movement along the South Carolina line. When you've got Albert Hainsworth, I think, is the party.
When you've got 6 different quarterbacks playing, you get some different cadence up there. So South Carolina's gotten pretty disciplined. It's sitting there waiting on their quarterback to make the
offside
call.
Offside on the defense. Penalty refused. First down.
They picked up a little over 5, so they're going to take the play. It'll become first down. Albert Hainsworth is from South Carolina. He's one of 6 Volunteers who's from South Carolina. And he threw as a true freshman. All right, Goodman operating in pretty good field position, certainly now at midfield. Gives it off to his tailback, and he gets about three down to about the Tennessee 47-yard line. Derek Watson hit by Albert Haynesworth.
You see your Haynesworth's name again. You mentioned the six players, and that's something that Lou Holtz has got to do to turn this program around. He's got to stop the stream of players leaving the state of South Carolina, coming to Tennessee, going to Georgia. Sean Ellis, Darren Walker, Dominique Stevenson, Kevin Gregory, Albert Haynesworth, and Tariah Smalls, all South Carolina products making big contribution on the Volunteers team.
All right, South Carolina sets a couple of receivers to the left, puts one in motion. That's Hood. Goodman takes a long count, drops the ball, picks it up, and maybe gets a half yard out of it after all. Exchange from center was not very good. It was pointed out to Lou Holtz that last year T. Martin completed 23 straight passes against South Carolina. And Lou said, we can't complete 23 exchanges from the center to the quarterback.
Yeah, he is everything, including brutally honest with his football team.
All right, South Carolina looking at a third down and six. Vol defense trying to dig in. South Carolina trying to keep this drive alive. Goodman comes down the line on the option and keeps it, and will be short of a first down. Deion Grant comes up from safety, number seven, to make the stop for the Volunteers.
Skip Holtz getting some yardage here, figuring out what to do now on fourth down. Here comes the punting team, looks like Courtney Levitt, but those are pretty impressive option plays by South Carolina. I'm telling you, we have not had an opportunity to be very successful running the option. That time we didn't have penetration, just didn't get enough yards to pick up that first down.
This time Tennessee will put Deion Grant back to receive the punt. Levitt will stand just across the his 45 and step into it at that point. Grant runs up to it and lets it bounce. It goes out of bounds here on the sideline at about the 15, 14-yard line. So pretty effective punt by Levitt. I tell you what, Deion Grant is the speculation, a lot of speculation about him, Andy, as to whether he will turn pro after this season, and I think there's more speculation that he will than he will not.
Well, I don't think there's much doubt that he'll be a very high draft choice. Maybe one of the top defensive backs in the country. Obviously, he is in college, and you know where he goes in the draft, that's hard to say, but I would say without a doubt he would be one of the top picks.
My vote is for him to go.
There's an old quarterback vote for you right there. Tennessee puts Graham in motion. They give it off to the tailback, and he's going to pick up 2 or 3 yards. Line of scrimmage was the 14-yard line. Jamal Lewis caring for Tennessee. Big number 31, who had a good game last week against Alabama, went over 100 yards for the first time since the Wyoming game.
Alabama game, he kind of broke out of a, if you can call it a slump. Jamal hadn't had the top games, you know, that he's used to having, but he did break out last week for over 100 yards, and maybe he's back on track to the Jamal of old.
Got 7 carries for 36 yards so far in this ball game. Again, they put Graham in motion, and again, they hand off to the tailback. Big hole, Jamal cuts back against it, and gets nice yardage for a first down up to about the 28-yard line before Andre Offing made the stop for South Carolina.
Tennessee can certainly move the line of scrimmage, but Lewis is so effective because he uses those little chop steps at times, which allows him to cut back against the grain, and that's so difficult for a defense like South Carolina trying to pursue, but then you can't overdo it because you know he can break your back with cutting back against you.
He is excellent at cutting against the grain, and some folks worried about that after his knee injury, but he's regaining that form. Here's a sweep out to the right, and this time it's Travis Henry at tailback, and he doesn't find much running room, as South Carolina did a pretty good job of stringing that one out and closing it down. South Carolina had a heartbreaking loss last week. Let's go down on the sidelines. I believe our man Terrence Cleveland has a word down there. Terrence?
Guys, Tennessee's leading wide receiver, Cedric Wilson, just went into the locker room. He injured his hamstring on the long ball that he dropped. I think they're going to take him in, apply some pressure, maybe some heat, put a sleeve on it, and see if he'll be able to go back upstairs.
Well, there's your leading receiver for the Vols. Here is handoff again to the tailback, and moving the pile for a couple of yards is Travis Henry up across the 30 to about the 32-yard line.
see Tennessee's getting a chance to play a couple of extra receivers. Now you see Bernie Beasy was in the game earlier. He just went out. But that's not the way you want to get guys in the game with your first teamers getting hurt. But it is another opportunity for some guys to get in and get more action that hadn't had a chance really all year to play very much.
Well, some teams have double-teamed Cedric Wilson this year, knowing that he is by far the favorite target for T. Martin. This time he spreads the field with four wideouts. T's got time, and he's going to tuck it and run, and South Carolina closes down nicely on this one, shy of the 35-yard line.
Nice hit there by Marsters. Cleveland Pinckney, and Matt Marsters, as you point out there, Bob. I mean, Cleveland Pinckney there, 62, had 32 tackles so far in the season, six tackles for a loss, and people have had to look at him constantly in that nose guard position for South Carolina, because he'll pursue, he'll run down the line, and he'll hit you, as he showed there.
When T first tucked, that looked like there was going to be some room to run. They closed it down very quick. But two very good defensive stands by South Carolina after the opening drive getting up the touchdown. They've come back and played pretty strong.
Nice high punt by David Leverton, and nowhere to go. Tennessee all over this one. Will Bartholomew was the man downfield to make the stop that time, and we do have a flag down. Did he give him enough room to catch the ball? I guess that might be the question.
That was awfully close. Looked like a good timing play to me, but I'll take the yardage for South Carolina. John Fabris, the special team coach for South Carolina, came from Kansas State. He's always had a team in the top 20 wherever he's been, and we have struggled so much this year.
During the return, blocking the back by the receiving team, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Well, there you see the top rushing defenses in the nation, and what do they have in common? They all are from the Southeastern Conference. That is incredible right there.
I actually see all five are SEC schools.
All right. South Carolina will put it in play. The handoff is to the tailback, and he slides to the 25, to the maybe 26-yard line. That's Nesmith, who obviously is going to alternate in here with Watson at tailback today. Watson is not 100%, has had rib problems, and I guess is playing with a flak jacket, didn't you say, Todd?
That's correct. He's had turf toe as well. That was the first look we got of the full house backfield for South Carolina. They put three backs in there, obviously, and try to tighten down the defense and just run at you hard. Skip Holt's not afraid to throw a lot of formations at you.
Mikhail Goodman, the youngster at quarterback, number 17, maybe checking off at the line of scrimmage after taking a look at the Tennessee defense. Again, he has the full house backfield. And he gives it off again to his tailback, and Tennessee smothers him this time. Raynock Thompson, a finalist for the Butkus Award this year, and of course has had a brilliant career at the University of Tennessee out of the state of Louisiana, and has turned out to be one of the vocal leaders on the team as well as one of the outstanding individuals.
Leads the team with 41 tackles. It's not hard when you see that situation with the fullback missed the block on him there, but he pursues so well, moves laterally so well.
All right, South Carolina facing a big third down and seven, and they go into the gun this time. And Goodman is back to throw, throws a little screen pass out here, and this could be and is a first down and more out around the 31-yard line or 32-yard line. Jacob Bush, the fullback. Good call that time by Skip Holtz. He caught Tennessee in the right defense and handily picked up the first down.
Yep, here out of the shotgun. Jacob Bush is a big kid, about 250 pounds, played fullback. He's had hamstring problems, but you notice not only can he go out there and run, but he can deliver a lick on you as well. We need to get him into the game plan a little bit more. Had 22 yards on five carries last week.
Officially, they put the ball on the 31-yard line where it is first down and 10 to go for South Carolina. Tennessee leading late in the first quarter under a minute and a half to go. It's 7-0. South Carolina moving with the football across the 35 is Nesmith this time, and Deion Grant makes the stop for Tennessee. Good yardage on first down. Leaves Carolina with a little more option.
We talked early in the show that Tennessee's defense talking about how strong they are up front and shutting down the run. South Carolina's come out, and especially the last couple of series, they've had some success running the ball. They're not backing down from this Tennessee defense. They're really sticking it to them and having some positive results.
And it's not exactly a veteran offensive line. These guys have had their problems along the line too, and contact is made. So Tennessee has Dominic Stevenson jump into the fray there and got caught.
Before the snap, the defense made contact with the offense. 5-yard penalty, still secondary.
That's two times for Tennessee to do that, and almost a third time.
As Andy so properly pointed out, Goodman using that count, delayed hard count, goes on to a lot. We had some problems when he first came into the offense using by it, but now they've gotten the cadence down for him.
You saw the penalty situation there. South Carolina 2 for 20, UT 3 for 15. And Tennessee almost jumped again. Sweeping it out here to the left, and this time they close it down very nicely, and there is nowhere to go for Nesmith. It was Will Overstreet who strung it out and made the stop for Tennessee. Take a look at Raynock right here, Andy.
Hey, Raynock is just one of another line of great Tennessee linebackers, and there were several in there this year. Just so quick, he missed the tackle initially, but got back up, got back into it. But he just had such a great year, and for his size, really not that big of a guy, but he can deliver a blow. He hits harder than he should, I guess, for his size.
They are going to measure. It's close enough for that, and it is a first down. I didn't think he made it, but he made a great last effort right there, a lunge, I guess, that got him the first down. So it's a big first down for South Carolina. It comes with 5 seconds remaining in the first quarter of play, and the score, Tennessee 7-0. Perfect day, 64 degrees, brilliant sunshine, and a crowd of over 100,000 here at Neyland watching the Southeastern Conference game. That will be the end of the quarter. So one quarter has gone by here in Knoxville. Tennessee Volunteers 7, the South Carolina Gamecocks 0. We'll be back. Well, we get set to go to quarter number 2, Tennessee 7-0. Andy and Todd, the Vols took the first chance they had and drove right downfield and scored. Made it look kind of easy, as a matter of fact. Since then, the Tennessee offense has not been that impressive, and the South Carolina defense has been impressive. They've done a good job.
Well, as you said, Tennessee, the first series came out, they went long early, had an incomplete pass, and then basically did the rest on the ground until the screen pass for the touchdown, and did look like they were going to take control, and did take control that first series. But since then, a couple of drop passes, one probably for a touchdown that Wilson dropped that he actually got hurt on. But since then, the South Carolina defense has stepped up, and really Tennessee on offense, other than the first series, really hasn't done much.
You see there the history of Lou Holtz. And he won the last time he was in here, but he was with Notre Dame at that time.
Yeah, don't remind me of that game.
Close one there, 34-35. Is that right, Andy?
Actually, that year was 34-29. We were on the short end. That was the score the next season, then we were on the good end the next year.
I was pretty sure you'd remember that one.
South Carolina with a full house backfield. First play of the second quarter. Goodman back to throw. He throws long and incomplete. Gary Hood was the intended receiver. Deion Grant was the man who almost got his 7th interception of the year.
Get a first real look at Mikael Goodman trying to throw the football. As I mentioned, stress fracture in that right hand. He does not have a great arm. He came out of high school really as an option quarterback, and they've worked on all of his fundamentals. He just throws off his back foot a little bit here, and Kerry Hood has to stop to try to go up and make that play.
Neesmith, by the way, has 5 carries for 11 yards in this ball game. South Carolina puts a couple of receivers to the right side at the bottom of your screen, and then in an eye backfield, and Goodman will go back and hand it off to his tailback, who picks up a little yardage up to about the 45-yard line. Derek Watson, and he's hit by Darwin Walker. South Carolina against South Carolina there. There you see the stats in the first quarter. And the big stat, of course, is Tennessee 7-0, but yards rushing 24-52, passing 12-24 in Tennessee's favor, and total yardage 76-36 falls. Just shy of the 45-yard line where it becomes a third down and 7. So let's see what Skip Holtz has up his sleeve here. Got two receivers at the top of your screen. Tennessee faking a blitz there. They put a little pressure on and really pound the quarterback. Hit by Westmoreland. A vicious hit, and he's not getting up. Dwayne Goodrich knocked it down in the secondary, but Andy, that was what you call one of those no help in sight and nothing to stop Westmoreland from roaring in.
Actually, that was a heck of a hit. Hopefully Goodman's okay. I admire him. He stood in and held it for as long as he could and actually delivered a pretty good ball. It was very close to being interference on against Tennessee, but you see Goodman waiting until the last second, and wow, that's a tough shot right there, and hopefully maybe just the wind knocked out, but that's a hard hit. But I admire Goodman for sticking in and actually delivering the ball on target.
See you moving down there on the field, Andy. I know you know this. When you're rolling to your left in that last minute, you're trying to turn your shoulders back to the line of scrimmage and your body's moving that way, there's no tougher hit that you can take, really,
right,
to your chest
when
there.
When you turn your shoulders to get it downfield, you're actually, as you'll see on the replay, you're exposing the big part of your chest when you're trying to get your shoulders turned on to the left, and that's a tough hit right there. Westmoreland got his helmet right in his sternum. That's tough.
He's coming off under his own power. It may have been a case, guys, where he just had the breath knocked out of him, because he's actually trotting now, so that is a good sign. So we're going to assume that's the worst it could have been for the youngster. And now Courtney Leavitt will go into punt formation, and Eric Parker will be back to receive for the Volunteers as South Carolina fails to convert on the third down situation. So it's 4th and 7. Parker standing at his 20-yard line. He's had one return this year of 69 yards for a touchdown. Thing Tennessee likes about him is he catches the football and he has no fear. They run into the kicker and the flag goes down. Here comes Parker back to the 30, 35, but this one's probably going to come back.
Courtney Leavitt's had two punts blocked this year. Crucial at times, and Tennessee smelling that out. I'm sure they put in a specific scheme to try to go after this one. They're just a little too aggressive there, and Courtney did get it off.
There's the official conferring with the South Carolina team, and if it's running into, it's 5 yards. Roughing, of course, is 15. They would be still shy of a first down. Stephen Marsh was the man, apparently, for Tennessee, who made the illegal contact.
If that's not roughing, I'd be shocked.
If it's roughing, it'll be a first down.
5 yard running into the kicker by the defense. 5 yard penalty. Repeat fourth down.
So they are going to kick it again. There was a decent return on that one. Here's the look again, guys.
Pretty good lick. Although, if they don't get under that leg, often they won't call the roughing there. So I thought he had his leg above him, but I know that's one that Lou Holtz is down there having a long conversation with the officials about.
Stephen Marsh is a defensive back, freshman from Wingate, North Carolina, who made the contact for Tennessee. So once again, Courtney will go into punt formation, and Parker will drop back, this time all the way back to the 12-yard line. We're fairly early in the second quarter, 13:45 to go. Tennessee leading in this ball game by a score of 7-0. Parker signals for a fair catch and makes it at about the 10-yard line. So Tennessee's offense, which has sputtered the last two times out, will go from that point, some 90 yards away from the goal line. Tennessee entertains Notre Dame here next week. South Carolina gets a week off, which they have been looking for some time, I'm sure. They're the last team in the Southeastern Conference to get an open date. Then they have remaining on their schedule Florida and Clemson. So it doesn't, Todd, get any easier down the line.
No, we call this portion of our schedule the Orange Crush, having to play Tennessee and then Florida every year, and really having your open date if you're South Carolina and struggling like we've been to try to compete in the SEC. Having it right before Florida, the end of the season, is another disadvantage, because The Florida Gators, of course, like Tennessee, have been tops in the conference for so long. We'd like to have that in a different area here. And then we end up with the arch rivals and Clemson, who are under Coach Bowden doing a nice job scoring some points this year.
There you see, remaining November 6th, they take on the Gators and then wind it up with their blood rival Clemson. Tennessee, of course, has still got several games remaining. They have Notre Dame, go on the road to Arkansas and Kentucky before closing out their season at home against Vanderbilt. UT rushing up to this point, 11 carries for 52 yards. And Lewis has 46 of those yards. So Tennessee puts it in play to put the Johnson, the tight end, in motion, and they give it off on the right side to the tailback. And Jamal slams forward for a couple of yards before Stamper made the stop for South Carolina.
Tennessee comes out this series a little different formation you hadn't seen today. Two tight ends, one goes in motion, just backed up in their own territory in the shadows of their own goal line. They're going to be a little conservative early. Well, I say that, you know, you never know, but trying to establish something again on the ground as it did in the first series.
All right, T. Martin with the eye backfield. One receiver set to his right. He looks, he's got pressure, and he's firing from that pressure, complete, and it's at the first down marker. David Martin.
You just can't say enough about T. Martin. It's no doubt in the last couple of ball games, he's been incredible. Two games, he's rushed for five TDs, thrown for two, and had 528 yards of total offense. He's just stepped his game up, as Andy pointed out early on in the broadcast here.
And I'll tell you, this is a heck of a throw, Todd. You can
out of his
attest
end zone.
To this. Out of his own end zone, really, off of his back foot, falling away, getting hit, and that ball had some mustard on it. They got out there in a hurry. Just a heck of a play by T. Martin.
T stands up, fires out in the flat. It's complete immediately. Knocked down is Eric Parker at about the 29-yard line where his forward motion took him. He was actually driven back two or three more yards, but Eric Parker picks up positive yardage.
Tennessee goes back to the old three-step game that we've run for years and years. A lot of teams do it, but Tennessee is no exception. That's one of the first plays that I learned as a quarterback at Tennessee is a three-step hitch. It's a great play. And as we call it, if you throw it and catch it, and if you get tackled on the spot, you're going to gain 6 yards. And that's exactly what happened that time.
Tennessee's got three wideouts, two at the top of your screen, one at the bottom, and they give it off to Jamal Lewis. He's got a big hole, and he's still going. Touchback. He's down to the 25, the 10. Touchdown, Jamal Lewis. Well, that looked like the Jamal of old, Andy.
Well, it did. He showed his strength getting through the hole, quickness, his cuts. And then when he got in the open field, he just showed his speed. A nice job by the offensive line. Tennessee came out early in the series with two tight ends, opened it up a little bit with a couple of passes, and then came out with three wide receivers. South Carolina spread the field a little bit on defense, and that opened it up for Jamal. Nice job up front, and then a nice run by Jamal getting to the open field and sprinting to the end zone.
Alex Walls. Extra point is up and good. It's 14 to nothing. It was a 70-yard run. And Todd, as you pointed out, he has that great ability to cut back against the grain, and you saw it really exemplified right there.
Well, and I tell you what, the one about 20 yards into it, that cut back against the grain is as pretty as I've seen in a while. You see here they're over-pursuing, and Arturo Freeman missed the tackle of the leg, but right there, that cut at full speed is so difficult to do. And you can see why Jamal in his career, even though he's a power back, he has had three runs now, 65, 67 yards. He can take it the distance. It's not just a 10-yard gain for him.
This will be a good level to see that cut when he makes an open field, how sharp he makes it right there, just right on the dime off his left foot. And as you said, Todd, he gets in the open field, and even though he is a big guy, he's got a great speed, and he shows it there.
Well, that answers any question about the knee, I think.
That's true.
His longest run had been for 67, so this has been the longest for Jamal, 70. David Leverton will be kicking off for the Volunteers. Back deep, South Carolina has been doing a pretty good job today in getting the ball away from that goal line and into decent field position. Leverton's kicks have not been what they were the last couple of ball games into the end zone. This time he rides it high and deep and long, and this one is out of the end zone. No chance for a return as it goes through the end zone and out, and so South Carolina will put it in play. First down and 10 to go at their own 20-yard line. 11:52 remaining here in the first half of play. There's the ball scoring drive. Four plays, 89 yards, took a minute 35. A 70-yard run by Jamal Lewis. Career record.
South Carolina must get some work here on first and second down so they don't get this defense back out on the field right away.
You saw number 43 on the sideline, David Leverton, obviously pleased with that particular kick. Here's the handoff to the tailback, nothing doing. Tennessee's left side closes it down. Garrick Watson could find nowhere to go. Number 22, true freshman. Boy, he has a lot of potential, though. Tell you what, Tennessee recruited him about as hard as you can recruit anyone.
I think Philip Fulmer was really disappointed he lost that one to Lou Holtz. And I think that's part of the reason why that Coach Fulmer would like to pound South Carolina Day if he can, because Coach Holtz is a real threat to the recruiting base in the SEC.
Lost a yard. It becomes second down and 11 to go for South Carolina at their 19-yard line. Goodman fakes the handoff under great pressure, fires out in the flat. It is complete. It's going to be a little bit shy of the first down marker, maybe by half a foot. It's Teddy Salters and Andre Lott made the stop for the Vols. It's maybe close enough that they'll measure. Those little passes, Andy, out of the backfield might be open for South Carolina.
Well, especially Tennessee came with the blitz that time. They brought the linebackers, and again, Goodman took a nice shot, but he stood in, held it to the last possible second, and got a nice completion and picked up the first down. But I think that's the first time today Tennessee's really come with an all-out blitz, and a nice job by Goodman picking it up and getting rid of the ball.
It does move the chain, so it's a big first down. Getting out of the hole is South Carolina. Goodman comes down the line on the option, tosses to his tailback. Tennessee rides him to the sidelines, but he gets a little yardage to the 36-yard line. Derek Watson. Well, we're seeing, Todd, some of the reason why they talk about poise with this young quarterback. He has taken a couple of vicious hits today, and he's still hanging in there and doing a good job.
You know, for a freshman to play in this environment and just not fumble the football every play is pretty exceptional. And Goodman has done a good job with that here. The only criticism he's had is he could be kind of lethargic at times and hadn't had good game management with his team. Doing a much better job today, though.
Well, it's a second down and four situation now for South Carolina. They give it off again to the tailback, and he gets about a yard or so, and that's about it. Derek Watson is hit by Dominic Stevenson, the middle linebacker for Tennessee. Brings up an interesting third down situation right here. South Carolina trailing 14 to nothing. I don't think you'd gamble at this point in the ball game. But Lou Holtz, his son Skip Holtz, we'll see. Guess what? They need 2 yards. I bet they run out of the full house. I bet Mr. Watson. And he got racked up. And so they will have to punt, I would think. He didn't make the first down, but Tennessee knew what the rest of us did, that Watson was going to get the football. Dominic Stevenson again made the stop from middle linebacker.
Two South Carolina boys there. Two plays in a row getting to meet one another. Outstanding players there.
Todd, as you said, big job for Lou Holtz is to keep that Carolina talent at home now.
Really do. And Tennessee and John Chavis, the defensive coordinator, and Dan Brooks, the recruiting coordinator, have constantly come into South Carolina and be able to pluck two or three or even four at times of the best prospects out of the state, because Clemson and South Carolina have been down for a while.
Low snap, Lovett gets his kick away, and it's a pretty good one. Chases Parker back to the 25-yard line. He's got running room. He's still running. Eric Parker is all the way into South Carolina territory at about the 32-yard line before he stumbles and is tripped up at that point. And Tennessee in tremendous field position right now.
Well, Parker did that time, just as Todd said earlier, on a punt return, you want to catch it and try to get upfield as quickly as possible. And Parker didn't hesitate. He caught it
really wasn't one man to make miss early, so he just hit the hole and hit it hard, just as Todd said earlier. You've got to hit those quickly. Parker did a nice job of getting the ball and getting upfield, and nice job by the Tennessee return team setting up blocks, giving him a wall to run up and just showing some great speed and almost taking it all away. Nice tackle at the very end to save a touchdown, maybe.
Brian Elam was the man who saved the day for South Carolina. 37-yard punt, a 43-yard return. Here's the pass out in the flat, incomplete. Intended for Dante Stallworth.
And Stallworth just fell down that time, lost his balance. Luckily for Tennessee, that was a forward pass. You know, they practiced it as a forward pass just in case something like that happens. But it sometimes can be close, but I know the Tennessee coaches and players work on that to make sure that that's a forward pass and just in case something like that happens.
By the way, Jamal has gone over 100 yards, so he has now tied Jay Graham for first place in 100-yard games. Here's T back to throw. Got time. Fires out on the flat. It's complete. I believe that's Bernie Vesey making his first catch of the year. Former quarterback here out of the state of Mississippi. Just an all-around athlete. No room at quarterback, so they said we got to get him on the field. They put him at wide receiver, and he's been banged up a little bit this year. Hasn't been real healthy until the past couple of weeks. And so, Andy, he gets his first taste of receiving right there.
Actually, Bernie is one of the fastest guys on the team, probably the top two or three as far as just pure speed and just a great athlete. I've heard nothing but good things about Bernie Vesey and his athletic ability.
They need three for a first down. It's third down and three, and T's going to throw the football. Now he's going to pull it down and run. And battle, it's going to be close. Think he might have had it. It's close enough that it's four down territory, I would think. Tennessee up 14-0 over South Carolina. We've got 7:47 remaining in the first half of play. There's T. Martin.
See his rushing stats there for the year. Last two games, T. Martin has done some really, really good things with his feet, running the ball, pulling it down on call plays and on passing plays. When things break down, as they did right there, it was a called pass. He didn't see anybody open, tucked it, and made a guy miss at the very last second to pick up the first down. So, again, T. Martin continuing to make plays, not only with his arm, but also his legs.
This time he gives it off to Travis Henry, and he's got nowhere to go. South Carolina strings that one out and closes it down nicely. Dennis Quinn, right defensive end, was chasing him down and did a good job that time.
That's really the first time today on defense that South Carolina has really played on Tennessee's side of the ball. They got penetration that time. Quinn did a nice job playing on Tennessee's side of the ball, and there was really no place for Henry to go. Nice job by Quinn stringing it out and playing on the Tennessee side of the football.
So it puts Tennessee in a second down and 14 situation. Ball at the 27-yard line of South Carolina. T. Martin with an eye backfield. Two receivers left, one right. Stands up, fires. Got his man open over there. It is Dante Stallworth, and he is down inside the 20-yard line before he is hit by Faison.
Again, going back to the three-step drop that the Tennessee hit earlier, just a three-step hitch route, and it turns into a 7, 8, 9-yard gain. Really, you get rid of it so quick that the defensive end or the linebacker in coverage doesn't have a chance to get to the flat, and you get it to the receiver before the corner has a chance to break up.
Well, Dante Stallworth, they have big plans for him, and he's getting better every week, getting more confident. Young man from California who came in with credentials, glowing credentials. It's complete to him, and there's a flag down, though. Flag dropped immediately as the play was getting underway.
Interesting formation that time by Tennessee. Trips to the left, started a guy in motion to have everything flood to that side and brought him back, and not sure they might have been moving a little bit there.
Flag was dropped so quick, you would think that, Todd. Here's the referee.
There is no foul. There was a miscount on the number of men on the line. There was the correct number of people on the line.
Well, that's good to see the officials get together and sort that thing out.
I hope that was right.
Oh, he forgot to turn the mic off.
Yeah, you clearly heard the officials say, I hope that's right. Well, anyway, it brings up a fourth down situation as Tennessee did not convert for the first down. And so it'll be Alex Walls attempting a field goal. It is up there, and it is good. So young Mr. Alex Walls puts three more on the board for Tennessee to make it 17-0. It's officially a 33-yard field goal for the Volunteers. From a South Carolina standpoint, they held him out of the end zone. A little bit of a morale lift right there, perhaps, but Tennessee able to get three more, run it out to 17-0. 5:53 remaining here in the second quarter of play. Bob Bell here along with a couple of quarterbacks. Andy Kelly from the University of Tennessee, who is still quarterbacking, playing for the Nashville Cats, and Todd Ellis, who holds the passing records at South Carolina. Now makes a living in the real world with defending people, I guess, or your prosecutor, Todd.
I'm a civil lawyer in South Carolina. Got a firm down there with 21 people, do a lot of different work.
Of course, down on the sideline is a guy who used to catch the passes for Tennessee, Terrence Cleveland. So we're all here on a great day in Knoxville, and good to have you with us. One of my all-time favorite friends is Charlie McAlexander, the voice of the South Carolina Gamecocks. We worked together against each other on TV in Nashville for a number of years, and then together on radio for a number of years. So good to renew friendships with Charlie Mack today.
He speaks so highly of those times.
David Leverton gets a lot of foot into it again and drives this one to the back of the end zone, and South Carolina will put it in play at the 20-yard line. So Leverton's first two kicks today were not that good, but the last two have been sensational. Can't say enough about him. Philip Fulmer really has had praise of this young man. Tennessee fans all know about Andy, his rocky start at Tennessee. It all started at California in a game against UCLA when he had such a horrible game and kind of lost his confidence for a while, but certainly has got it back big time now.
As you said, Bob, he's bounced back in a big kind of way, and having a huge year for Tennessee has been one of Tennessee's big weapons.
South Carolina with Goodman at quarterback rolls to his right, wants to throw, got a man out there, but may have been tipped. That scoring drive for Tennessee, 7 plays. There it is, 7 plays, 17 yards, took 253, 33-yard field goal by Alex Walls to cap it off and make it a 17-0 ball game.
Ball.
Part of the big crowd here at Neyland.
Ball was actually tipped that time, as you pointed out there, Bob, and Jacob Bush got to do a better job of cutting those guys down out on the end there when we sprint out so we can get a lane to throw in.
Goodman, 2 of 6 for 33 yards. He's got two receivers at the top of your screen. He gives it off to his tailback, and he's spinning this time and gets up to the 25-yard line. That's a big guy named Pinnock, Andrew Pinnock, who I guess Todd at one time was a fullback and weighs about 250, 255, and they put him in their tailback, and I guess he's had a couple of games where he fared pretty well there.
He really has done well. He'll play both those positions, but with Watson being slowed, he's played the tailback position. Didn't play the first 4 games because of the clearinghouse, trying to get him done through the NCAA. Since coming on, though, he's made a big impact on our team.
There's Charlie Mack, the guy in the sweater vest there. We were talking about a moment ago. Pressure on Goodman. He fires, and it was the pressure that caused him to fire a little off the mark to Andrew Pinnock. Tennessee really rushing in that time and putting South Carolina in a punting situation. Fourth down coming up. Parker, who had a great return the last time, will be back there to receive, and Courtney Levitt, who's from Memphis, Tennessee, will be standing at his 11-yard line. Courtney's numbers on the day, 36-yard average. I think he's averaging just shy of 40 coming in here. Dante Stallworth actually steps back to do the receiving this time instead of Eric Parker. He lets it bounce and is going to fumble it and pick it up and bounce around out there and finally get knocked down on the 34-yard line. So, Andy, does Dante get another chance?
little shaky on his first chance to return a punt. Until you see the ball rolling, he actually let it hit the ground. As a punt returner, if at all possible, you want to make the catch and not let it hit the ground. That time he couldn't get to it, picked it up, and actually did a nice job avoiding a disastrous play and trying to get a little bit out of it. But I don't know. We I don't know if we'll see Dante returning too many more punts. You never know, though. Maybe that's just the first-time jitters.
Well, it's a 46-yard punt, 5 yards on the return. And Tennessee goes on the offense right now with T. Martin and an I backfield. Two receivers on the left side. T. pumps and fires long. Ball really hanging up there and hanging up too long. It's intercepted by South Carolina. Back up to midfield is Sheldon Brown, the free safety. Tremendous long throw, but guys, both of you ex-quarterbacks, that one was just too much air under it.
Yeah, a little too high. Tennessee tried a hitch and go with Scott using his great speed. Tried to, T. Martin made the pump. See the play fake. He came out with the pump fake with the hitch and actually held it a little bit too long. And then you see the pressure there. I didn't see the pressure earlier. The pressure forced the high throw and turned into a huge play for South Carolina.
31 yards on the interception. South Carolina in Tennessee territory at the 49-yard line. Two receivers on the left side. Goodman looking down that way. He wants to air it out long. Tennessee defender fell down, and the safety came over and saved the day.
Almost a carbon copy of the play. Tennessee just ran the play before.
Yep.
Little hitch route out to the outside there. Pump and go. Jermell Kelly there. He's actually second behind Robert Brooks in touchdowns during his career. Got 15 now, could break the record of 19. Robert Brooks, pretty darn good receiver at South Carolina, play with me, but can't get free this time. And again, Goodman just not able to get the ball down the field there.
Well, that was Deion Grant and Dwayne Goodrich back there, and Deion got a hand on it. And there you see the reaction of the youngster at quarterback, Mikhail Goodman. All right, he's looking now at a second down and 10 situation. Ball at the 49-yard line of the Vols. He's got pressure. He's going to be sacked. Four Vols are standing by him, led by Anthony Sessions, reserve linebacker, making the stop, but three other Vols were right in the picture as well.
You just can't do that if you're a young quarterback. You see there, he kind of got disoriented in the pocket, realized how long he'd had it. Tennessee brings a strong safety for the second play in a row. Blitzing, got to get rid of the football. If your football team is only averaging 7 points a game and you're at midfield with an opportunity after a turnover, you can't give up one like that.
Six hurries and seven knockdowns for Tennessee today. Here is Goodman back in the pocket again. This time he gets more pressure, but he gets it off and completes it. A nice play. Got to be shy of the first, but nice, nice play that time to Ben Fleming, wide receiver, who cut right into the middle to make the catch.
Ben's a senior, 5'11", 201 pounds. He's one of the most consistent receivers we've got. Not afraid to go across the middle there, but like so many of South Carolina's receivers, we got to learn to turn it up the field once we catch it. Haven't done much after we've caught the football.
Remember, they needed long yardage about 19, so it's shy. Deion Grant is back to receive on a fourth and four situation. Deion signals for a fair catch and makes it inside the 10. Crowd might have thought the defender was a little too close, but the official did not. So it's on the 9-yard line. First down and 10 to go for the Vols at that point. Tennessee had Cedric Wilson, their leading receiver, averaging almost 100 yards a game in catches, go out with a hamstring. And we'll await word on him later. There's a good shot of the massive crowd here. And the numbers are 105,941 in here to see this game today. If there's a more perfect day for football, I have not been around it. Usually at this time of the year, we began to get a little chill in the air in East Tennessee. Neil Johnson, tight end, goes in motion. They hand it off to the tailback, and he's going to pick a little room up, Jamal, up to about the 13-yard line before he is stopped. Andy, they're carrying over the same situation we saw in the Alabama game last week. Late in the game, they ran that series with the tight end going in motion, four or five times, I guess, in that ball game.
They did that, ran off tackle, and they ran several sweeps in that series, I think three or four in a row. But, again, you see Tennessee coming out near their own end zone, the same as the last series, came out very conservative, two tight ends. They threw on second down earlier, but obviously wanted to get it out away from their end zone and get in better field position.
Same play again, and this time they got across the 15, maybe, to the 16-yard line. I think I saw a flag fly into the pile down there. So we're going to have an infraction called on somebody here.
Nice play by Cleveland Pinckney, not allowing that center to get across his face.
Looks like it's going against the Volunteers. South Carolina pointing in that direction.
On the offense, half the distance of the goal, repeat second down.
And he might have been on the receiver, David Martin. He was looking kind of flustered after that play.
Well, it's really hard to say. The receivers are such an important part of the running game, not only at Tennessee, but at every program. The receivers are such a vital part of it. Everybody thinks, well, this offensive line has to open the holes. Well, that's true. But once a running back breaks in the clear, he has to have some help, and that's the receiver's job, and it's very important for those guys to be blockers.
Big down here, third down and 12, and he will not get it. So South Carolina will be in a good situation right here.
Well, this will bring up a third and long. Actually, after the penalty, it was repeated second down.
Yeah, I'm sorry. You're right.
But still a good situation for South Carolina. A third brings up a third and long and deep in Tennessee's territory. This is an opportunity for the South Carolina defense again to come up with a big stop and give their offense a chance in decent field position again.
We've got a minute 29 remaining in the first half of play here in Knoxville at Neyland Stadium. 105,000 plus. Tennessee leading 17-0. Coach Lou Holtz going to bring the South Carolina team back, and in time he will. It's been a rough year for the team, though. A lot of injuries, a lot of youngsters who've had to play. They've used six different quarterbacks this year. They've had all kinds of problems in addition to not having an open date and having a brutal schedule. All of those things have mounted up for the Gamecocks.
Bob, we've had six different offensive lines start in eight ball games. An example of that, Tennessee on the other side has only replaced one player the entire time in their offensive scheme. And South Carolina has three offensive linemen, and only about 2 or 3 months ago were defensive linemen. One time we started seven freshmen on offense, redshirt and true freshmen.
Actually had a couple of walk-ons that have had to play some, right?
That's correct.
That's so tough. It's such turnover. Even if you have good players going in, if you don't have cohesion, the guys used to playing with each other, that's really, really tough.
They're down and nine now. They try draw play, and it's going to be successful for a first down and a lot more with Jamal Lewis. Sheldon Brown from free safety made the stop.
Look at the sideline now. I see the Coach Former and the Tennessee coaches. They got the big first down. They were probably content to run out the clock, but after this big play, the coaches are going crazy now on the sideline trying to get the offense going. Since they got out in good field position now, they're going to try to make something happen, maybe get another field goal opportunity, get some points on the board.
Back to the live action. Pass is complete out here in the play. Incomplete. They rule it to Crosby, the fullback, coming out of the backfield.
Go back to the draw play, Tennessee. I'm sure the thinking was, let's run the safe play. Don't give South Carolina something big right before the halftime with a chance for a turnover or a big play. Ran the draw play, and it turned into a good play for Tennessee, and now they're in better field position. Now with a minute 10 left, enough time to possibly go into the two-minute situation and try to get the ball down the field. This will be a big play in determining whether they'll go for it down the field.
All right, T. Martin has got a little time and throws it wide. Pretty close to interference right there. The crowd certainly is calling for it, but not the official. David Martin was the intended receiver.
Arturo Freeman there on the coverage. T. Martin there holding the ball a long time again. South Carolina brings the blitz. They realize it's also an important down as well as to whether the drive will continue.
There's a flag down here at the 32-yard line. I don't think this was thrown right after the pass play, but here's the official.
Sideline warning against the visiting team.
Well, sideline warning against South Carolina. Let's take a look at what they're upset about. Don't know, guys.
Don't know. Maybe they're looking in the line. Maybe thinking Tennessee's
something
getting
else,
away with a hold
yeah.
or something. I don't know.
Obviously, I don't think it was that play that or that series that we saw there that upset them. T. Martin now looking at a third and 10 with a minute one to go in the first half. In the shotgun with time. Fires complete. And the ball is loose for a second. I think Tennessee hangs on to it. But I thought it was coming loose there. It was out there for Leonard Scott.
Nice catch by Scott that time. He had to go up in a little bit of a crowd and make the catch, made a nice grab and got the big first down. Tennessee now, Tennessee's now into the full two-minute situation where they're trying to hurry, get the play called, get the line of scrimmage, and conserve as much time as possible.
T rolls out of the pocket and fires complete, but hit immediately in his tracks is Leonard Scott, just shy of the 50-yard line.
Again, though, the clock's going to stop with the first down. Actually, I think Tennessee may have called timeout and actually didn't need to. I think that was enough to pick up the first down. Tennessee may have wasted a timeout right there with the first down in college football. The clock stops to reset the chains. Tennessee had a chance to get to the line of scrimmage and call another play.
Give South Carolina's defense a chance to kind of regroup as they gather around their coach.
It really does. You see Scott coming off the line of scrimmage, releasing against his own defense, finding a seam, finding an opening. T. Martin rolls a little bit, makes the throw, and a nice first down. And then, again, Tennessee, in my opinion, Tennessee just wasted a timeout. What do you think, Todd?
Well, the thing about it is you see Coach Fulmer on the sideline over there at one point, kind of upset with a couple of players there. And if you're in that two-minute offense, you really got a shot now for a field goal with 32 seconds to go. You might want to talk to him about two plays, get three plays in, rather than have to single out one at a time. You could tell your quarterback what you want him to do if you get a completion. So I think you're right, though. I always like to save those timeouts.
Oh, without a doubt. If you have timeouts, it really doesn't matter. You know, you can get down to 10, 8, 7 seconds. You still have time maybe to run two plays. So, hopefully for Tennessee's sake, maybe that won't come back to bite them in this series. But I'm like you. I like to save my timeouts, especially if the clock's going to stop because of a first down anyway. I know T. Martin and the offense is coached well enough to be able to get the line and get the play called and get it off. But again, it may work out that the timeout was the best thing.
T. Martin is 8 of 14 for 83 yards, a touchdown, also an interception today. All right, 32 seconds remaining. Tennessee at the South Carolina 49-yard line. Passed it out in the flat intended for Leonard Scott, right at his feet, low pass, couldn't hang on. Not sure you would have gained a whole lot out of that anyway, guys.
That used to be the play that just ate South Carolina's defense up. We could not defend the wide receiver screen inside. We've gotten a lot better at that. One reason is we're faster. Kenny Harney, our middle linebacker there, can run and pursue and get out and get those receivers before they get up in the middle. And our secondary is a little more athletic than they've been in the past.
Not much time off the clock on that one. It's 27 seconds to go right now before halftime. And T is looking at a second and 10, but the clock is the factor here. Got pressure, got the screen off Jamal Lewis. He does have big yardage down to about the 36-yard line before he is knocked down. And it's another first down, so that does stop the clock while the chains will be moved. And then it'll restart immediately. So Tennessee's already got their play. They're up to the line of scrimmage, and there's a little bit of confusion now.
Kill the clock there.
They just spike it with 14 seconds to go. And there was movement everywhere by everybody on both sides as they tried to get the clock stopped. Tennessee did, and they were successful in doing that. So, Andy, you got yourself 14 seconds to work with right here. One play and then a timeout if you can complete it in field goal range.
Illegal substitution on the defense. Five-yard penalty. Still first down.
And that's a big 5 yards in this situation. With 14 seconds, you have time to run a few plays. With two timeouts remaining, it would be better with three, as I said earlier. But, if you have a chance, you can still throw to the middle of the field, and you don't have to work the sidelines in this situation because you do have two timeouts remaining. So, really, anything you can do, anything, even, possibly run the ball here with a draw or something like that. I wouldn't be shocked to see that with Jamal, the success they've had with the draw play today.
Tennessee's got two receivers set left, two to the right now. The ball is on the 35-yard line. The clock shows 14 ticks to go before halftime, and balls are up 17 to nothing at the moment, trying to score. Either they'll go for the end zone or try to get in field goal range for Alex Walls, who has already kicked one 33-yarder today. T has got Bobby Graham started in motion and now stopped on the right side, and T throws it out here a little too far in front of the intended receiver, Bernie Vesey. And so it's 8 seconds to go now.
Well, South Carolina came with a blitz that time. That's a blitz adjustment by Tennessee. Vesey, the inside receiver, run the quick out, the outside receiver run a quick slant. That's just a blitz adjustment, and just didn't get it done. South Carolina brought more guys than Tennessee could block up front. The quarterback and receiver saw it, just didn't hook up for the completion.
They're going to try a field goal. Ball will be spotted on the 37-yard line. A 47-yard effort here by Alex Walls. Ball is set down. The kick is on the way. It's long enough. Is it? Yes, good. 47-yard field goal by Alex Walls. Andy, his longest as a Volunteer, which has been a short career, of course, since he took over for the injured David Loudermilk.
That actually had room to that was been good from 50 something. That was a heck of a kick by Walls. Right there, you see it, the replay right down the middle almost. And actually had plenty to spare on that one. Nice kick.
Great boost for him there, Bob, because he was 0 for 2 so far after 40 yards of greater length. So he got himself a little bit of confidence for the young kicker there.
Well, he's a happy camper right now. And so we've got 3 seconds to go. Tennessee will kick off. South Carolina will have a chance on the kickoff, but that would be the last play of the first half of action here. The scoring drive, 12 plays and 61 yards. It took 2:33 off the clock and was capped by that 47-yard field goal by Alex Walls. Now David Leverton will kick off for the Volunteers on what will be the last play of the first half. 105,941 basking in the sunshine here in East Tennessee. Good crowd over from South Carolina, including their band here to perform at halftime. Here's Leverton. He puts it on the ground, a little squib kick, and it's going to be picked up out to the 25 and out to the 30-yard line by Derek Watson, where he is down, and that ends the first half of play. So the first half ends here at Neyland Stadium in Knoxville, Southeastern Conference battle. The score is Tennessee 20 and South Carolina nothing. We'll be back in a few here at Neyland.
The Southeastern Conference setting the standard. Unprecedented year in athletic and academic achievements. 12 member institutions committed to excellence and the promise of the future. The Southeastern Conference, where champions are made.
Yeah, Jamal is a man on a mission right now because he watched the team win a national championship without him. And he wanted to be a part of that.
You know, Jamal is just wanting to get that starting role back. So that eye of the tiger has to come back and that aggressive, you know, mode has to finally set in. Well, basically what I'm trying to do is with Jamal is get his speed back.
Faster, 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 faster. Good, good, good.
Get his power back. And get his cutting ability back.
Yeah, I'm 100%. I worked hard this summer, got stronger, got faster.
And he's always asking me to do extra.
Go! Come on. Sprint! Come on!
Chad Long, you know, he eased me through it and helped me out, so Stucky wouldn't put too much on me, you know, because he'll take the weight up a lot. So Johnny Long kind of worked with me this summer, and everything was, he's great. I'm ready.
It's been really a grueling 12 weeks for him. You know, we've taken Jamal to the limit, and he's pushed himself to the limit.
That was good just to push it. They pushed it, and I just went along with it.
He loves to work. He loves to be the best that Jamal can be. That's what makes him, you know, a pretty special guy.
How do you measure progress? For more than a decade, students from the University of Tennessee's College of Education have volunteered in rural towns like Oneida to improve local schools. Kenzie Patterson doesn't know that test scores have gone up in her hometown. All she knows is that school has gotten just a little bit better. How do you measure progress? One victory at a time.
Well, it's halftime here in Knoxville with Tennessee enjoying a 20-0 lead. Andy Kelly, your assessment from the ball standpoint of the first half. Have to be well pleased, I would think.
Well, not a bad first half. Tennessee came out early in the game, the opening series, took it down the field, got the big touchdown to start the game off right. South Carolina's defense came back with a couple of stops, but as a half went on, Tennessee settled down a little bit on offense, made some big plays, a big run by Jamal Lewis for the big touchdown there. Tennessee's defense, on the other hand, pretty solid first half. South Carolina has had some success running the ball a little bit, a little more than I thought coming in the game, but overall a pretty good first half for the Tennessee team.
Todd Ellis, on the other hand, Tennessee gets the first chance and makes it look pretty easy. South Carolina could fold at that point. They did not. They hung in there and gave it a good shot.
It's a tough football team, and they've gotten some turnovers already. T. Martin throwing off his back foot a couple of times. And as Andy pointed out, they've done well when they've gotten the full house backfield running the football. But what we need is more chances to get some turnovers and get good field position for the Gamecocks offense, because it's very difficult to drive at 80 yards against this Volunteer defense.
Turnovers what they really need right now.
We really do. You've got to get some opportunities, and you know, we've had 27 this year so far going into this ball game, one of the worst margins in the country. We need our defense, like Arturo Freeman, Sheldon Brown, who got the pick in the first half, a couple more of those to give our offense an opportunity.
We've got another second half of football to go and more halftime activity. We'll be back here at Neyland right after this.
I think now people are finally realizing that the Volunteer strength is coming of age.
Coming of age.
Well, when I think about our weight room and our weight program, the first thing that comes to my mind is stuck.
I'm very fortunate to be with Coach Stuckey here.
He's tough now. I'd have to say he's the best at what he does. His big thing is not just to be a big old strong guy, but to be powerful and explosive.
Strength and conditioning, it makes you a better player because you get strong, get physical, you know, your body is able to go through
12 to 13 games a year.
It plays a major role in you going to that next level.
At the University of Tennessee, we know about winning. The University of Tennessee. We also play a little football.
You've got a cute way of talking. You got the better of me. Just snap your fingers and I'm walking like a dog hanging on your lead. I'm in a spin.
With Tennessee center Spencer Riley broke his right hand and continued to play against the Florida Gators last weekend, he endeared himself to Tennessee fans everywhere. You might say Spencer Riley embodies the kind of football player that Tennessee coaches and fans expect and want to wear the orange shirt.
And then you just go look in the Hall of Fame room downstairs, and they tells you about tradition, you know, and it's all about tradition. It's about people who know how to work hard and play with pain, you know. And that's the way I see it.
Former Tennessee stars Eddie Brown and Condridge Holloway know Spencer's story all too well. It was in the 1973 Tennessee-Kansas game when defensive back Eddie Brown blocked his field goal. That block cost him his three front teeth. He later went on to return an interception to lead Tennessee to a 28-27 win over the Jayhawks. Quarterback Condridge Holloway injured his shoulder so badly against UCLA in 1974, he had to be taken during the game to UT Hospital to have it x-rayed. He made a dramatic return late in the game and he scored a miraculous touchdown that helped Tennessee tie the Bruins 17-all. Spencer Riley's story is just as courageous. After breaking his snapping hand on the second play, Spencer refused to come out of the game, not wanting to let his teammates down.
You know, this is my senior season, you know, and I'm one of the leaders of this group, you know. I'm a leader by example, and it's for me to be out there.
This week has been no different for the Tennessee captain. Had a cast put on his right hand Sunday, making it impossible for him to snap the football with his normal hand. So instead of taking time off and missing a couple of games, this gritty competitor has learned how to snap left-handed.
It's not rocket science, you know. You know, you can do it right-handed, you can do it left-handed. It just takes a little bit.
Obviously, Spencer Riley is tough as nails on the football field, but he does have a softer side.
Beth, I give you this ring.
As a sign of my vow.
As a sign of my vow.
Spencer Riley married the former Beth Doolin this summer and says that married life has helped him strike a balance in the rough and tumble world of college football.
She's a great listener. She's learned to listen to me. It's interesting to come home, and you know, you're used to coming home to some guy when you're living with my old roommate, you know. Now I come home to Beth, and she's a lot better looking than he was.
Spencer's love for Tennessee football kept him in the fray against the Gators last Saturday in the Swamp. But marriage has given him a very new perspective.
She means so much to me that, you know, I could give everything up and not even bat an eye about it. You know, if something ever happened to her and I had to go take care of her, you know, it would never bother me to give it all up.
Tennessee's Spencer Riley, a loyal member to his family on and off the football field.
Back for another one of those block rocking beats.
The great thing about Fuller as drum major of the Pride is he's just intense. You know, sometimes it's probably a little too much. That's why when we created a new cheer, we knew Fuller was the man to spread the word.
The band goes, da-da-da, down, go, ball.
You know, whatever he's doing, I hope it's tasteful.
Halftime winding down here in Neyland Stadium. The Volunteers leading South Carolina by a score of 20-0. I'm Bob Bell, along with former Vol quarterback Andy Kelly and former South Carolina quarterback Todd Ellis. And down on the sidelines where we're going right now, former Vol receiver Terrence Cleveland. Terrence?
Got the injury update at halftime. Eric Parker.
Halftime winding down here in Neyland Stadium. The Volunteers leading South Carolina by a score of 20-0. I'm Bob Bell, along with former Vol quarterback Andy Kelly and former South Carolina quarterback Todd Ellis. And down on the sidelines, where we're going right now, former Vol receiver Terrence Cleveland. Terrence?
Got the injury update at halftime. Eric Parker wasn't feeling all that well before the game. A little flu-like symptoms. It's possible if he'll return. Cedric Wilson suffered a strained hamstring. He probably won't come back to the game. Coach Rumor talked to the team about at halftime about setting the tempo for the second half to be able to reach that level to be one of the great football teams in Tennessee history. Back upstairs.
Okay, thank you a lot, Terrence. Let's take a look here at Todd at the halftime stats. Anything jump out at you there?
Well, I can talk about the UT rushing yards, 149. Jamal Lewis on his own getting 70 of that on that rushing touchdown that he had. The time of possession, though, not as much as I thought, Bob, actually. The discrepancy there, 15-47 for USC and Tennessee, 14-13. Thought it would be actually be the opposite of that. South Carolina, though, got to do a lot better rushing the football. Obviously, the sacks there hurting them a great deal.
All right, let's take a look at some of the highlights, Andy, of the first half action.
You see Tennessee coming out their first touchdown play. The screen pass to Smith with a nice job getting out in front, a nice play call. Coming out the first series of the game and getting points on the board, that's really big. Later in the game with the Jamal Lewis with a huge, huge touchdown run, the nice cut in the secondary and showing his feet, getting in the end zone, opening the gap a little bit. And then coming back later with a couple of field goals, Alex Walls actually showing a nice leg on the second field goal, which is a 47-yarder. They had plenty of room to spare, but a nice job by him coming into a game and getting some good kicks and building his confidence a little bit. But a pretty good overall first half for Tennessee. The only negative I can really think of is the turnover, the interception by T. Martin. But other than that, a pretty solid first half.
All right, we're set now to battle in the second half here in East Tennessee. 105,000 plus in Neyland Stadium, and David Leverton will be kicking off for the Volunteers. South Carolina will go on offense first here in the second half to see if they can get something going. There's Derek Watson, true freshman who's been banged up some this year but is playing here with a flak jacket. He's had some rib problems, and if you've ever suffered a rib injury, you know that's terribly painful and there's not much you can do about it except suffer with it. Here's Leverton approaching the ball, gets up another nice kick. This one goes into the end zone where it's unreturnable, just a half yard or so in from the out of bounds line, and so Leverton does his job again. South Carolina will go on offense, first down at the 20-yard line. Todd, would you think they might try to put it in the air a little bit more in the second half?
Well, the success that they had really running the football was out of that full house backfield. I'd like to see him get into that and then show some play action from that set.
Tennessee leading 20-0. Goodman has gone all the way at quarterback. They've alternated their tailback some, but Goodman has been the man at quarterback. Steps back, gives it to his big ex-fullback, now tailback, and Pinnock gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that's about it. He is smothered by the right side of the line. Looks like Henderson, one of the guys there, Big John.
Gamecocks being blanked right now, and what's surprising about this is that Lou Holtz has never had a team in his 27 careers average less than 29 points per ball game. That's all the way up the time of Notre Dame and way back to William and Mary, and now only average 7 points per game. I don't think this will be a trend that will continue.
It'll be second down, the ball at the 21. They need time for a first down. Straight eye backfield, two receivers set to the right. Pittman wants to throw. He's got a yard line carry. Hit by Dwayne.
Going to hurt Barry Hood's receiving average there. Nice.
Gutsy play by the quarterback. Raynock Thompson chased him down along with Dwayne Goodrich. Got to admire South Carolina guys. What have you got to lose?
That's right. Go for it. Certainly not going to punt it down in there. Courtney Levin, although he's had some punts down inside the 10-yard line, struggling with that a little bit lately. So give yourself a chance to win the ball game or to get a score here early on in the second half.
They started this drive on their own 20-yard line after the kickoff went into the end zone, and finally Tennessee takes over now. First down and 10 to go with the ball just outside the 25-yard line of the Vols. There's T. Martin. Got two receivers set to his left, one to the right. Got a straight eye backfield this time with the fullback in there. Crosby, tailback Jamal. Stands up, fires out there, had a man breaking wide open and overthrew him. David Martin couldn't have been much more open than that, Andy.
I'll tell you, that's the three-step drop. It's a hitch is what it's called. But as we said earlier in the season, we talked about this, that route actually is a hitch is called, but it can turn into to several different things. It can turn into a slant route. It can turn into the hitch that is called, or it can be a fade. And that time, Martin read a fade. David Martin read a fade. T. Martin obviously didn't think that he was going to run that. The corner came up. Actually, I think David Martin made the correct decision to go by the corner because he broke on it.
All right, T. Gibson fakes it to his fullback. Has the man out there, but South Carolina recovered nicely that time. Bobby Graham was the intended receiver for the Volunteers, and it's broken up, and a good play by South Carolina defensively.
Sheldon Brown here, you look at him, play action is a lethal if you can, but he closing speed. That's what we've not had in the past. Ball a little bit behind the Tennessee receiver there, but you can see why the Gamecocks are ranked second in the SEC in pass defense.
Third down conversion, South Carolina is 2 of 9, UT is 3 of 5, and they're facing a 3rd and 10 situation right now, and T keeps everybody in the backfield and goes into the shotgun. Got three receivers out. Fakes a draw and then is going to go deep. He's got a man there and overthrew him. David Martin was downfield in pretty good shape, Andy, but again, he led him just a little too much.
A nice play fake by T. Martin, faked the draw. And again, as the interception earlier, I think T. let go of the ball just a hair late. Martin had to step and had a chance to be open downfield, but the ball got there a little bit late, gave the safety a chance to come over and be involved. And maybe T's holding on to it just a hair too long.
So it'll be a punting situation for Tennessee. David Leberton gets his kick away, and it's a nice one. It's bobbled for a second, and then the receiver, Ryan Brewer, is dropped after he gets it across the 35-yard line. Tennessee had Philip Crosby getting up a little bit slow and limping, but he walked off under his own power. So South Carolina, with a defensive stand, will now take the ball over in pretty good field position for the Gamecocks. 9:21 remaining in this third quarter. There is a shot of Philip Crosby, and he was banged up a little bit on that play, and I don't think he's very comfortable right now. It seemed to be an ankle or a knee, but he did walk off all right. Carlos Spikes is in at quarterback. Is that right?
I think I saw number 10 go in there.
That's a former wide receiver. Todd, tell us a little something about him.
Yeah, Carlos is 6 foot, 190 pounds, has played receivers, caught 6 balls this year. We've used him some at quarterback. He was 3 and out against Vandy, an old option quarterback who played the option game in his senior year in high school. His junior year, he had 1,100 yards receiving. So he's a versatile athlete. South Carolina likes to use him in these running situations. Option certainly is very capable, but I saw him throw a couple balls this week, and the guy's got an arm as well.
He's one of 6 quarterbacks that South Carolina's Lou Holtz has had to use this year. So Carlos Spikes is your QB now for South Carolina. Rolls back, gives it to his tailback, who's trying to sweep wide right, and he does a good job. Getting across the 45 is Derek Watson. Fred White made the stop out at about the 46-yard line. Just a quick pop that time, sweeping to the right, trying to find a hole in the defense, and he did a pretty good job, Andy.
Nice job. I thought at first Tennessee was going to have it strung out, but Watson does a nice job finding the seam, popping it really hard, and actually picking up about 8 yards. A good first down play for South Carolina.
Well, just across the 46 of South Carolina, where they'll look at a 2nd and 2 situation. We have a Kevin Johnson is down, guard for South Carolina, and obviously in some pain, and is coming off the field.
Another injury for us in the offensive line. I believe I'm going to send Andy down there in a minute to put some number on him, let him play tackle.
Derek Watson has 7 carries for 20 yards on the ball game. Tennessee leading 20-0, 8:32 to go in the third quarter. Gives it off to the first man, and not much doing there. Tennessee jams that one up. Jacob Bush, who had 1 big pop earlier here in the ball game. This time the hole closed rather rapidly. The ball is at the 49-yard line of South Carolina. Gamecocks in possession.
Got to watch Carlos Spikes. He's had a little trouble getting the snap, as a lot of young quarterbacks do when they get in there. Haven't been in a while. New center, so if he doesn't turn it over, he is a threat once he gets that ball and gets going in the option game.
Well, he got enough. He needed 2 yards, and he got enough to move the chain. So a new set of downs for South Carolina. It's first down and 10. Carlos Spikes is your quarterback, former wide receiver, but as Todd told you, a good athlete. Full house backfield. They give it to Derek Watson. Watson's trying to string it out. Cut back. There's just no room as Tennessee chased him down, led by Will Overstreet. Fred White, the whole secondary up there also, but Overstreet, who has very, very good speed, was able to chase Derek Watson down.
It's a little spin out of the full house backfield. You see there, they cut down the linebacker, and that's probably where he should have gone to, right there.
So he lost a little bit on that one. It'll be now a second down and 13 with the ball pulled back to the 46-yard line. So Spikes now has two receivers set right, one to the left. He rolls down, cuts it back in the option, is still running, still got some room, gets to the sidelines and make a great play. Turned what looked like a very short gain into a very sizable gain down to inside the Tennessee 30-yard line. Dwayne Goodrich had to make the play.
Well, it may not mean much in this ball game as it's fairly long gone, but this will be a confidence builder for Carlos Spikes. And we talked about his athletic ability in the option game, ran it in high school. And there, I don't care what you say, you can't teach that. That's just instincts on when to cut back against the grain there. But a nice pickup for Carlos Spikes.
Okay, South Carolina moving with the football. Tennessee leading 20-0, 7-11 to go in the third quarter. A lot of time. Carolina trying to build up some confidence and doing so on offense. Here's Strong pitching back. This time, or Spikes pitching back, and a yard or two is gained by Nesmith. Obviously, Andy, they've got this young man in to try to spread the Tennessee defense out a little bit because he is a threat to run the football, very obviously a threat. So a little bit different look as far as South Carolina is concerned with him in there.
Well, it is a different look. They did run some option early with Goodman with a little bit of success, but nothing with the capabilities of Spikes to make the big play. And I'm really impressed. The last two series for South Carolina, even though the last series they got down to this part of the field and didn't get it on fourth down, but actually put together two pretty good drives here in the second half.
All right, they're looking now at a second down and 9 situation at the 27-yard line. They give it off to Derek Watson, and Watson tries left guard and tackle. The ball may be loose for a second. Eric Westmoreland met him at the line of scrimmage from a linebacker spot. They're unraveling down there. No signal yet, but I believe South Carolina still has the football.
Derek's put the ball down on the ground a couple times this year, partly because of the ribs. He may have gone to the right side there. Yeah, there's Melvin Page. Got the block there, and if Derek would have cut to his right there, may have had a little more room. He's driving.
Another angle.
Yep. Actually, I think Westmoreland did get it out, but I think a lineman for South Carolina was there.
You're right.
Right on the spot to pick it up, but the ball did come out for a split second.
All right, here's a big down. Third down and 8. Ball at the 26-yard line of Tennessee. He's going to run with it all the way. Never any doubt about it being a run, and he's driven out of bounds short of the first down. Fred White drove him out of bounds. But Carlos Spikes took that ball, never a thought of throwing it, and just tried to use his speed around the left side and get downfield and couldn't quite do it. But he is banged up a little bit right now, I think, also.
I'll tell you, for South Carolina, if he's hurt, it's Todd, you can probably speak better on this because he's been with them all year. But, you know, when it rains, it pours with the injuries and the bad luck.
Didn't seem to be anything real serious. They're going to try a long field goal. It is up there, and it is no good. Long field goal attempt by Steve Florio. No good, but hey, a pretty good drive by South Carolina to get down and at least give it a shot right there. And so Tennessee will take over at the 25-yard line. See how close it was, guys.
In there, but it's slightly.
Very close.
Very close. Florio's a guy, if you can even believe this, he's had a bad quadricep pull earlier in the year. We couldn't use his services. And Courtney Levitt, our punter, was doing double duty, and we were struggling big time in the kicking game. But, you know, South Carolina cannot be satisfied with just driving the ball down there. Obviously, against a great Tennessee defense here who has the ability to stop the run. It was a nice drive, but we've got to be able to punch it in there. We need a big play guy in those situations to come up with a play.
Tennessee maintains a 20-0 lead, 5:20 to go in the third quarter. Vols taking over offensively. They fake it to the full tailback. Little pass out here in the flat. It is complete. This could be very big. Dante Stallworth down the sidelines all the way down to the 27-yard line.
Well, Bob, Tennessee comes right back to the play early in the game. They set this play up, and Dante Stallworth fell down before the ball even got to him. This time he didn't fall down, and it turned into a big play for Tennessee. Nice timing by T. Martin to get it out there to him quickly. Nice job downfield by the Tennessee. The other two receivers were out in front. I'm not sure who it was, but nice blocks downfield. You'll see here Stallworth. T gets it out quickly, gets the ball in his hands. Nice job. I see David Martin out there getting in the way, running some interference. I think Leonard Scott throwing some blocks downfield, and then Dante Stallworth has nothing but green grass in front of him.
Well, Tennessee right tackle moved on that play, so it's going to be 5 yards against the Vols. 38 yards on that play by Stallworth after receiving it from T. Martin.
Start on the offense, still first down.
So the ball is pulled back here to the 32-yard line, where it becomes a first and 15 for the Vols.
Thing you got to like about that play with Stallworth is you're just getting one of your better athletes out on the corner and give him a chance to do what he does best. That's make people miss, and it's very difficult to defend that.
All right, T. Martin with a eye backfield. He puts Bernie Vesey in motion. He gives it off to Jamal, and Jamal uses power to pick up yardage down to about the 27-yard line. Got back to about the original line of scrimmage. Jamal goes out, and he's either got an equipment problem or an injury, but I think it's equipment.
Let's hope it's not that shoulder that's been giving him some problems. But he did walk off kind of look funny, holding his arm in an awkward position, so hopefully it's not his shoulder that's been banged up. I see a lot of people around him right now. Could be his shoulder.
Oh, so that could be a major story. Second down and 10 as he got the 5 from the penalty back. T. Martin in the shotgun, and the whistle blows it dead. We've got 4:21 remaining in the third quarter of play here in Knoxville.
Delay of the game on the offense.
Clock ran out on T. Martin, so another 5-yarder. Tennessee's had two what you might call little silly mistakes in this particular series. One movement by the right tackle, and now just delay of the game. And there's a shot of the sidelines, and Jamal Lewis is in a little bit of trouble. They've taken the pad off. It is the shoulder, Andy. He's patting
that
shoulder.
Left shoulder. That's giving him some problems this year.
T with plenty of time throws it incomplete.
Tennessee tried to set up a screen that time that they scored on earlier with Smith, Simmer, and Smith is limping now on the sidelines. But he got hung up in the crowd, couldn't get out. T. Martin tried to string it out as long as he could and just had to get rid of it. As you see Smith there again.
He comes up limping also.
I don't know what you think, guys. I mean, if this is not an important game for the BCS standings, would these players still be in here at 20-0 with 3:58 to go? It's not that it's that late in the game, but still, you got to wonder, is there pressure to really make this a decisive win?
Well, Cedric Wilson has already gone down, and we probably won't see him again today. T. Martin trying to scramble, and there's nowhere to go as he is knocked down.
There's Ray Green, our secondary player. Strong safety, free safety plays. Blitzing there. Charlie Strong, defensive coordinator, came Florida. Used to be at Florida, defensive line coach when they had such great defensive down people up there. Went to Notre Dame. Calling signals for us, doing a very nice job.
Well, Alex Walls is going to attempt a 50-yard field goal. Really, it'll be a shade over. Ball is put down on the 41-yard line. It's up there. It is good. 51 yards for Alex Wall. Wow.
I think Alex Wall is coming, having a coming out party today here against South Carolina. Heck of a kick. A nice day so far today. That was a heck of a kick there. Had barely got over the crossbar, but that's all you have to do is get it over. But a nice job by Walls coming in today, and hadn't had a lot of opportunity this season, but he's making the most of them today for sure.
There it is, just over, but it is good. It's 23-0 in favor of Tennessee. But Todd, you make a point. They came in here favored by 33, and if you don't win by 33, people who vote in the polls and the computers might take a negative look at that.
Yeah, who knows what those computers can crank out. I guess there's about 8 different factors they look into it after they look at the major polls, but it's just an interesting part of college football right now with the way that they have the BCS rankings and how it plays out in the bowl games. But you have problems like this, things start to happen. I hope we have a couple more undefeated teams this year, so there'll be more pressure to go to a playoff. I think it's very doable, keeping the bowl systems in place to a certain degree, and it's what everybody wants.
All right, David Leverton will be kicking off for Tennessee after the Alex Walls 51-yard field goal. Here's the kick. Going to be one of those hard-to-handle things that's going to bounce and go into the end zone. Derek Watson comes out of there at 10. He's out to the 15, and it's going to be dropped short of the 20-yard line where South Carolina goes on offense. 2:59 to go in the third quarter of play. Tennessee up 23-0. South Carolina started this day with Mikael Goodman at quarterback. He went the first half, and here in the third quarter, they decided to insert Carlos Spikes, who is obviously a very solid athlete who can run the football. There's Tennessee scoring drive. 5 plays, 41 yards, 2:08, 51-yard field goal by Alex Walls to make it a 23-0 score. First down and 10 to go for South Carolina. Give on the left side, and not much cooking there for big Andrew Pennock, 250-pound fullback slash tailback. Raynock Thompson made the stop. Let's go down to Terrence Cleveland. Terrence.
Guys, we talked about at the beginning of the ballgame, Tennessee wanting to get an opportunity to play some young players. They didn't want that to come because of injury. Jamal Lewis has gone down with an injury to the same shoulder that's been giving him problems all year. They're going to ice it. Maybe he'll be able to return. Maybe he won't. Back upstairs.
I would think not if Tennessee can maintain their lead here. Notre Dame's coming in next week. Tennessee jumping, and a flag is down. Was there movement by South Carolina? Was Tennessee offsides, which they have been a couple of times in this ballgame? We'll await the official ruling. 23-0 balls, and South Carolina, while Tennessee entertains Notre Dame, South Carolina gets a much-needed week off before closing out their season with Florida and Clemson.
That Notre Dame game, is that here next week, Andy?
This will be here in Knoxville.
For the snap, the defense moved into the neutral zone, causing the offense to move. That's a 5-yard penalty on the defense, still second down.
All right, you heard the call. There's Jamal's day. 14 rushes for 146, averaging 10.4 and a touchdown. So I would think he is through for this day for sure. Penalty, South Carolina 3 for 25. Tennessee has been penalized for 42 yards. In this game, ball is at the 25-yard line. Give is in the middle to the fullback, and he gets a couple of yards in there that time. Salters carrying out a fullback.
Been pretty impressed with South Carolina's offensive line, obviously against the very strong Tennessee defense. There's Teddy Salters. He's been used more of as a blocking back in the past. But look at the guard here, pull inside, try to get a little piece of a Tennessee player, and Teddy Salters doing a good job of rolling away from that. But we're actually getting some movement up front today against the very strong Tennessee defensive front.
Ball is now first down and 10 to go. Just shy of the 30-yard line of South Carolina. Hand off this time to the fullback again, and he gets dropped after about a yard. Salters comes back with basically that same play, and this time Constantine Ritzman, a true freshman defensive end, closed in to make the stop. They put the ball right on the 30-yard line, where it becomes second down and 9 to go for South Carolina. Carlos Spikes at quarterback. Here's the give. Keep putting on the stomach of his fullback and kept it. Nice play. Andre Lott knocked down Carlos Spikes after he picked up a couple of yards. But I can tell you, this kid is very impressive looking as far as running the football. He gives you the impression with just a little daylight, he could go all the way on any play. There are the numbers rushing today. South Carolina has gone over 107, so they have already surpassed what Tennessee has been giving up this year, and that, Eddie, is less than 75 per ball game. So
first team this year to go over 100 yards against Tennessee. That's something to say in itself.
This will be probably the last play of the third quarter out of the shotgun. He's going to be swarmed under and driven down to the ground by Darwin Walker. Bernard Jackson was there also, but it was primarily Darwin Walker, strongest man on the Tennessee team, who benches over 500 pounds.
Actually, Walker looks like he split a double team that time to get in and get. He showed some of his strength right there. South Carolina front had a double team, and he split it as a defensive lineman. That's what the only thing you can do against a double team is try to split it, and that's good technique and good strength to come in and get the sack.
Well, as we end the third quarter, they have brought Goodman back into the ball game at quarterback. He is the man who was sacked that time. We've got another quarter of play to go here. At the end of three, it is Tennessee 23, South Carolina nothing. Well, as we get set, Todd Ellis, to go to the fourth quarter, they change back quarterbacks once again. Back with a guy who can probably throw a little better. Certainly, Carlos Spikes brought him a little bit of a thrill there as far as running the football. But now you've got a quarter to go, and if you're going to throw the football around, I guess you go back with your original starter, Goodman, there.
Yeah, he might be in there. He's been 25 of 51. One interception only, as I pointed out in the pregame, and one touchdown. That's only about 49% completion, but he doesn't hurt you that often. But for South Carolina to take it to the next level and for us to compete like we want to in the SEC, we've got to get ourselves a better throwing quarterback than what we've got. You look at what Alabama's gone to now, what Florida is doing throwing the football, so much around the conference, Georgia as well, Quincy Carter, Romero Miller. You got to have a mobile quarterback who can also throw the football now.
Well, we'll start the fourth quarter with South Carolina punting to Eric Parker. Courtney Leavitt standing back at his 10-yard line, so Tennessee should get it in very good field position here. On a fourth and 16 situation. Big sack by Darwin Walker. Took him out of any kind of a gambling situation. Here's the kick. It's nice and high. Parker settles under it and got hit actually as he caught the football. So there will be a penalty against South Carolina. Remarkably, he held on to the football.
I tell you, that was a heck of a catch by Parker because he got hit as soon as the ball got there. He was getting hit. That's pretty good concentration on the part of Parker, just holding on to the football.
Brian Elam was the man who got there a little quick. Tennessee up 23-0 over South Carolina. 31 yards on the punt that time. Had a little height on it, but not as much distance as he would have liked. Early seconds of the fourth quarter in Knoxville. Got to give him a couple of yards. He didn't really give him a couple of inches. Catches it and bang. Elam right on top of him.
Violation of the 2-yard buffer against the kicking team. 5-yard penalty. First down.
That puts the ball right on the 50-yard marker, and at that point, Tennessee will take over.
This is where
Martin remains a quarterback.
Excuse me, Bob. This is the point where South Carolina cannot allow this game to get completely out of hand. I don't know if we have the offensive capabilities to come back, but we're tired now. Our defense has been on the field a great deal. We don't have the depth that Tennessee has. And you want to play tough. Try to find some positive things that you can take into the rest of the season.
T. Martin is 10 of 22 for 145 yards. Jamal Lewis, 14 carries, 146 yards, but sitting on the sidelines with his shoulder pads off and an injury to a shoulder that has already been giving him problems. So that's a major story in this ball game. along with Cedric Wilson, who had a hamstring injury early on. Those are two very, very key people for Tennessee to have banged up as they head down the stretch here. Volunteers 23-0 with the football at midfield, first down and 10. T sends receivers, one on each side. Tennessee might try to pound the football right here, and we've got movement as Carolina jumps offsides. Were they drawn off? That will be a decision we'll hear from the field in a moment by the referee.
Tennessee this time takes a little bit out of South Carolina's playbook with the hard count, trying to draw them offsides.
Offside,
may have done it.
Defense, 5-yard penalty.
They did indeed. So it's down to the South Carolina 45-yard line, where it becomes first and 5 for Tennessee.
Actually, Tennessee calls that the freeze play. That means everybody freeze. You don't move until either offense, defense jumps offsides or the quarterback checks off.
Travis Henry carrying the football just shy of the first down marker. Travis in for the injured Jamal Lewis. We'll try to find out a little bit more about that. But as Terrence reported, they're going to ice him down now, put ice on that shoulder and see what happens. I don't think under any condition they'd bring him back in this ball game anyway. Well, with the Irish coming to town, injuries to Jamal Lewis and Cedric Wilson loom large at this stage. It is now second down and about a yard to go for a first down. They give it off to Travis Henry, and he has the first down and about maybe